concert. Mm-hmm. How old were you when you guys made the move down here?
So I actually, I was a junior in high school, and I switched to move up to Pasco. Okay.
So yeah, that's a tough year to move, you would think.
It was a tough year for me in high school. It is really weird. Like I mentioned, my grandpa had passed away. I was really close with him, so that was super hard on me. And then like I said, I had some issues with some friends. Not to get too crazy into it, but basically, like, a couple of guys that I thought were super close with ended up, like, robbing my house.
Oh, God, yeah, yeah.
So it was just, like, shady shit, and so it was just, like, I need to get out of Dodge. So it was kind of my own choice. Not saying that I didn't have a bunch of friends in Prosser still, but, like, I just need to be out of that situation.
Right.
So when I got to Pasco, I didn't know anybody. I mean, nobody. I listened to a lot of music with, like, because, man, when you get to Pasco, the rules are a whole lot different than Prosser.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I didn't have teachers that were like, you know, no hats, no this, no that. Man, at Pasco, I had my iPod in every day.
Yeah.
Shit, I was taking the homework home, doing my homework, and I wasn't listening to a damn word the teachers were saying for the most part, you know? Just the diversity of Pasco High. I mean, in Prosser, we had, like, what, maybe 3-4 black kids in my class.
Right.
I go to Pasco, we have a lot of black people here.
Yeah.
I'd never been around it. So that was interesting and eye-opening to me to be in that type of, like, oh, this isn't, you know, you're not in Kansas anymore.
Right.
I'd met some cool people through Pasco, but I had reconnected with a lot of my Prosser friends.
Yeah.
And they were like, dude, you should just come back and graduate here, you know? And I only had half a year left, so I was in the second half of my senior year. So I ended up moving back to Prosser, reconnected with all my friends. That was probably, like, the best time. I never loved high school, but definitely that last half of my senior year when I was, like, able to reconnect with a bunch of people and, like, we just had a blast. That was a fun time to, you know, it felt like for all the shittiness that had happened the year before, it came back.
Kind of made up.
Made up for it, yeah. Yo, sometimes change isn't the worst thing, you know?
Yeah, man.
It may seem like it at the time because you're uncomfortable, you don't want it. Like, COVID sucks for everybody, you know?
Right. Yeah.
But it's put me into positions where I've learned new stuff. I've went out and practiced with photography, which is something that I've always wanted to, you know, do and practice on, so.
Yeah. No, I think it forced everybody into really digging in, you know, and kind of, like, figuring out who you are, what you want to do type of thing.
Yeah, I mean, it made me life check myself real quick, like, what do I want to do? Because I'm not going to sit here for a year and just waste a year of my life.
Right. Exactly.
That's not, like, that's just not acceptable to me. So figure out what you want to do, set some goals, and let's start working towards them. You know, whether it's professionally or for fun or whatever. Like, I think about this all the time. You know, I'm 32 years old now, and I've been DJing, you know, since my early 20s. What happens if we lose, like, 2 or 3 DJs that are in Tri-Cities?
Right.
All of a sudden, there's nothing to do in the nightlife.
Yeah, man, that's crazy.
So to all the young kids out there that want to be DJs, I'm looking for you.
Yeah.
I assure you, I'm trying to find you. I want to put you on.
Yeah, man, that's dope too. You know that you have that mentality of putting people on, because you know a lot of times, you know, people get that in their head of like, I'm the one. You know, like,
yeah,
you know, especially when you got a big name. You know, like yourself. I remember, you know, you did like the boat race weekend and all that. You know, I remember going to the Red Line one. That shit was crazy.
For sure,
know?
Yeah. Yeah, and it's wild to me because, I mean, I kind of found DJing through a weird rabbit hole too, but I don't have a lot of kids that are like asking me anything.
Right.
Like, in all honesty, there's not a lot, and I don't know if it's because like when I was their age, I had no idea what a DJ was, what a DJ did. I had no clue what being a, I thought it was a dude on the radio that literally just pressed play.
And
that was it. I didn't really know that, like, because I don't come from hip hop.
Yeah, yeah.
So for me, you know, you have an MC and a DJ.
Yeah.
I don't know what that is.
Right.
I have no idea, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah, it was when I finally was like, oh, okay. Dude, I still never forget the first time I seen someone mix two songs, and I was like, dude, it was like, honestly, it was like seeing like aliens or magic in real life or something, you know?
Yeah.
And you're like, what?
Yeah, I mean, I know plenty of people are out here, you know, DJing and, trying to figure out what it is, you know, to DJ or be a DJ.
So one of the biggest problems with that right there is, like you said, there's lots of people that are out here DJing.
Yeah.
But there's not a lot of people out here that want to be a, for lack of a better term, a public DJ.
Oh, okay.
So there's people that are like, hey, man, I play hardcore EDM music, right?
Right.
That's great. No problem with that whatsoever. the problem is that if you want to get paid by a business or a public event, if you can't promote and get enough people in that building that all love that same music and your skills and everything else, guess what? There's no money for you to be made there.
Right.
Because either you can't promote it, which is a whole nother game. You got to be able to do marketing and make your own flyers and then get it out and have a following and all these other things.
Right.
Or, you know, you're so bad. And I mean, like, I wasn't good when I started either. So right, full disclaimer. But like, you're so bad that like you're turning people away, or or you don't have the personality to be able to handle people. You know, someone gets mad at you because you don't have a song and now you don't want to do it anymore.
Right.
So, you know, that's why I try to tell people, I'm like, yo, if you can mix, I don't necessarily enjoy doing weddings, but it pays the bills.
Exactly.
I love playing in the nightlife because then I can play, you know, the top 40 tracks that are out and mix it with songs that I love.
Right.
You know, like, I'm a huge Prince fan. I play Prince every single night at the sports page. No, not all night long.
Right, but just...
But I'm fitting it in there.
Right.
You know, I'm playing all the big songs that are out at the time, but I'm also mixing in stuff that I like with my personality and my touch.
So, after that, where was it that you made that connection? You know, because you said you didn't grow up with, like, hip-hop or anything like that. So, what changed? What made you say, you know, I want to be a DJ or start at least going into that space?
Right. So, two part answer.
Oh, okay. I thought you were going to say Tupac.
Tupac. Actually, and that's crazy because it really is Tupac.
Oh, really? Wow. Okay.
Like, no bullshit. Dude, that's no dope. Bullshit.
That's crazy. Okay.
So, I grew up, my dad listens to, like, classic rock, Zeppelin, Hendrix, Prince, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
My mom is, for the most part, more of a, at the time, pop, even, like, country pop. I remember, like, Shania Twain was big.
Okay,
Stuff like that, you know. But she does also like the classic rock. John Cougar Mellencamp, Tom Petty, stuff like that.
Yeah.
But nowhere did either of them listen to anything somewhat rap-related at all, right? So, my dad was really big on pushing me to learn computers when I got to about 5th, 6th grade.
Yeah.
By the time I got to 8th grade, I had internet out of my house. You know, the old ding, 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 ring, ring.
Loud ass fucking AOL and all that.
All of that, right? So, I remember, man, like, this is back when nobody knew about pirating music. And I'm like a 6th, maybe 7th grade kid at the time. And I've somehow, through whatever rabbit hole, you know, I got on the internet, I had Napster.
Oh, shit.
And this was before, like, the mainstream people had it. Like, kids at school didn't know what I was talking about when I was like, I had Napster. Now, looking back, I really had no idea what I was doing. As the memes all say, you know, like, I gave my computer 10,000 viruses so I could download the new Nelly song.
Yeah, man.
I remember a friend of mine, through his, I don't know, if older brothers or whatever, they were big Tupac guys.
Oh, okay.
They loved Tupac. So all I knew is I seen a bald-headed black dude that was heavily tattooed up. Mm-hmm. They had a very different style than anything I'd ever seen with the bandanas, no shirt on, you know, all this. And they started, like, kind of teaching me about the songs. Like, hey, this is what he's talking about in this. Because I didn't know nothing about West Coast, East Coast, nothing about Death Row, nothing.
Yeah.
So for Christmas, I had asked my mom, because I had been, like, a couple months into it. I asked my mom, yo, I want this book on Tupac. So my mom's like, I don't know what a Tupac is, you know? So she got it for me, and this whole time I'd been downloading Tupac music, which then, you know, you get Tupac, you start learning about who Snoop Dogg is, you start learning who Dr. Dre is, and mind you, I didn't have TV at the time.
Oh, okay.
So there was no MTV, there was no...
Hey, that's wild.
So my, I would come to Tri-Cities, and we had TV up here, and we would get MTV, and I know this sounds so cliche, but I seen this white dude rapping.
Oh, of course, of course. Hey, man, Eminem was 5 years when he came out. That's
and
I
was like, oh, my God. There's a dude that looks like me that's doing this music now that I've come to love.
Right.
Because I didn't know anything but Vanilla Ice, honestly.
Yeah,
I'm like,
yeah,
there's no other white guys doing this. And, I mean, it was to the point where I ended up bleaching my hair one time.
Yeah,
like,
damn.
I was the real Slim Shady.
Yeah. That's crazy. Is there a picture of that? I gotta see it.
Oh, yeah, dude. I'll pull it up. It's a black and white. It's the only photo I have of it. It's a black and white photo. It's of me on the track team in a school yearbook. I'll scan it and send it to you. It's hilarious.
That's awesome.
But, yeah, so that's kind of how I got into the hip-hop. And then, like, going back off that, 1 year my dad wanted to push, you know, me in electronics and stuff.
Yeah.
So this is super early. He bought me a CD burner.
Oh,
and this is when CDs were like 25 to 30 bucks for a blank CD. Well, when kids found out that I had it, and they were like, how do you got these CDs that you can just, because I had like a little Walkman, you know?
Oh, okay. Yeah.
How are you getting the songs that you want on this CD? I'm like, oh, I just burn them. Yeah. And of course, they're like, I don't know what that means. I'm like, basically, I can make your greatest hits playlist, you know?
Yeah. And you were like, what grade?
At this point, I'm in seventh grade.
That is nuts.
Yeah. Man. Wow. So, and I wasn't charging anybody. I was only like, they would give me the money for the CDs or bring me the CDs. They'd give me a list, and I'd be like, hey, I'll have it for you next week.
Damn.
And burn it out for you. So, I remember there was a girl who, like, I had the hugest crush on. She was a year older than me. And she was like, yo, let me get this. And I'm like, oh, I'm getting this tomorrow day. You know, I'm going to have this done by tomorrow.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, you know, what kind of music is this? I've never heard of any of these, but, like, maybe one or two. And I don't know how she knew it, because she's also from Prosser, but she was big on the Southern rap.
Oh, shit. That's great.
And that was the first time I ever heard Ludacris.
Oh my God.
And immediately, man. So like, I'm big on music history and like the sounds of where it comes from, this and that. So for me, hip hop was like Pandora's box opening. I'm like, right. Oh my goodness. All I really knew was West Coast.
Right.
I didn't know who Biggie was at the time still. You know, I'm starting to pick up these, yeah, like Eminem. Okay, that's Detroit. You know, I'm starting to pick up some of these things. But I heard Ludacris for the first time, and I remember distinctly it was Southern Hospitality. And the first time that beat hit, I was like, holy shit.
Yeah.
This is different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, you know, Ludacris got an extremely clean flow, too. So then at that point, I got into high school. I loved hip-hop music. The love had taken me over. You know, I'm fully in it. I end up moving to Pullman for what I thought was going to be school.
Okay.
What I thought was going to be school.
Yeah,
you know, I'm trying to figure out my career path, trying to figure out what I want to do. And at this point, I still have no idea what I'm doing.
And you're already there.
I'm there. I figured this was my game plan. I had already gone to CBC, started working on general stuff, just got bored, decided I need to change the scenery, and decided I was going to go there, figure it out.
Yeah.
Figure it out on the fly while I'm there.
Yeah, as most college students.
For sure, at least to some degree, right?
Yeah.
But the only thing that happened when I got there was, I got there in the summertime, so there was no school or nothing. I had a job, I was just working, it was boring. And when school started back up, it was like, whoa, this place parties.
Oh my God, yeah.
So, back to Pasco, I had some buddies that, you know, there was guys I knew, but I didn't know them.
Right.
And they were like, yo, but we're going to our other buddy's house, you know, come kick it with us. So now I'm in Pullman with some guys from Pasco that I, you know, I knew and we were friends. And they introduced me to some more Pasco people.
Yeah.
Well, one of those dudes was my boy JJ, D Triple J, shout out my man. And he had his apartment and, you know, it was just people just hanging out, just a little kickback before we were going to go to the bars.
Right.
And there was music coming on, and I remember, like, that moment.
Mm-hmm.
I heard the two songs mix, and I'm in the other room. And I'm like, I'm doing one of these. Like, what the fuck was that? Because
yeah.
I've never heard DJing, right?
Yeah.
So, and they're like, oh, yeah, JJ DJs. Now, he and I would both tell you, like, at the time, we were trash.
Right.
Like, I literally knew nothing. And he was basically working on, like, a toy setup, you know?
Yeah.
I started asking about it, and I'm sure he was like, bro, you're bugging, dude.
Yeah.
But it was like 21 questions. He didn't know me like that then, you know? We were like, I had known who he was, but I didn't know him.
Right.
And I'm asking him 21 questions. I knew I was just staring at his thing like, holy shit. Like, what
the
is
the light just coming.
Yeah, what is this? What is this? And no joke, dude, I'm not kidding. Within 2 to 3 weeks, I had to go apply for my classes and everything, right?
Yeah.
And it was like $10,000 I was going to have to pay.
Because
I was living in Moscow, which is in Idaho, right?
Right.
So they wanted me to pay for a dorm room and all this stuff. I'm like, you already got an apartment. Why am I paying for this? They're like, oh, standard fees.
Jesus, that's crazy.
I called my mom. I called my dad. And I was like, yo, I'm going to buy DJ equipment with my monies. And I remember they were like, what? And I was like, yeah, I have no idea what I'm doing, but like, this hit me in one night. Like, I'll figure it out.
Yeah.
And you know, as both of my supporting parents did, they were like, all right, well, here we go.
Yeah, that's dope, man.
You know, and of course, you know, my mom, my dad, they don't know a damn thing about what DJing is or how to get into it. So my mom, trying to be as helpful as possible, she's buying me like DJing for Dummies and like, DJ like DJ business, like how to get into the business side of it,
right.
You know? And of course it's just so overwhelming for me. I don't even know how to mix two tracks. I don't know how to count music. I know nothing.
Jesus.
And I just went to YouTube for like a year straight.
Oh man, YouTube
classes, bro. The University of YouTube,
man,
every day watching people to, I would watch, still to this day, my favorite DJ is A-Track, who I found him, because I don't know who any DJs are. Right. The only guy I knew who, just by the name, was Jazzy Jeff, because of Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Right. So I literally Googled Kanye West. He was my favorite rapper at the time. I Googled him. Who's his DJ? It turns out it's this A-Track dude.
Yeah.
So I started watching his routines, and I mean, I'm like watching this same video 55 times.
Yeah.
To like, I'm trying to learn one thing he's doing in that video until I'm like, okay, because I had my setup at the time.
Yeah.
And I went and bought the same stuff that I seen he had.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know what he was doing with any of it, but I got the same stuff, so I know it can do it.
Right, right.
So I'm sitting there like, okay, he hit this button, and then he hit that button. No idea what they do, but I'm sitting there playing with them, trying to figure it out. You know, it was like watching the monkey that you give them the drum set.
That's wild, man.
So I just finally started figuring it out, dude. And then
that
like
insane that that's how you learn. You like taught yourself.
Yeah, and it sucks. Like, and that's where I'm saying I wish there was young kids that I could at least give them a jump start.
Right, right.
You know, everybody's got to find their own sound and everything, but at least I could point you in the right directions on how to get there.
Figuring it, like when you finally got it like figured out, when were you like, okay, now I got to go work? How did all that start clicking?
That never happened for me.
Really?
It never happened because a series of events took place that took that need away. I have some good friends that go by the last name of Lim, Andrew and Alex, shout out to my boys.
Yeah.
And it was their birthday, and they knew that I had been, you know, starting to DJ, and I had been practicing a lot. And they were like, hey, dude, we're having our birthday party at this spot called the White Buddha. White Buddha was a real small but very cool spot. You would have loved it, had neon lights.
Oh, my favorite. Yeah. Yes.
So a very cool spot, very like chick, small, but like it felt kind of exclusive. Oh, the whole bar was plexiglass and lit up.
Oh, damn.
It was
cool.
Was this? It was actually right in front of Carmike Cinemas in the little strip mall.
Dang, I don't remember that.
Yeah, so they were like, hey, we know the owner. We're cool with the owners because we go there a lot. We're going to have our birthday party there. Like, are you down to DJ it? I'm like, yeah, sure, I'd love to.
Yeah.
Now, at the time, I'm using, like, a home stereo for, like you would use for movies, like a surround sound.
Okay.
So I figured out how to, dude, I knew no hookups.
So
like,
insane.
Everything is just jerry-rigged, right? So they were like, well, our buddy, Sam, he has speakers. Shout out to Sam Hernandez. And Sam, I didn't even know him at the time. He was like, dude, I got speakers you can use. I got cabling, da-da-da-da-da.
I love people like that.
So anyway, so Sam got me hooked up for, you know, the birthday party. We get out there, and at the time, I was just trying to play to the vibe that they had in the thing. So I was playing, like, a lot of, like, Deadmau5 sounds, right?
Oh, okay.
Because that's kind of the vibe that they had. They kind of like that electronic, like, deep sound.
Yeah.
So I was playing a lot of that. And I remember at the end of the night, mind you, I had never played anywhere out. This is the first time I'd ever played in public.
So it was your first gig?
Ever.
Okay.
Ever.
Man, how old were you around this time?
So I had to have been about 23-ish?
Around
22,
there?
23.
Okay.
So right in there. And at the end of the night, you know, I'm thinking like, oh, this was fun. This was a blast.
Yeah.
Da, da, da. And I'm like packing my stuff up. And the owner comes up to me and they're like, hey, you know, how much do you charge to DJ?
Oh, wow.
I'm going to be blatantly honest. I have no idea. This is my first night ever playing. And they're like, well, we want to hire you. And I'm like, okay, like, great. How much do you pay?
Yeah.
And they're like, how's $100 a night sound? And I'm like, holy shit, you're going to give me $100 a night to play music?
Damn.
So, bam, there I was. Next weekend I was starting there. I was there every Saturday for a year, man.
So now with, like, COVID, like, how did that affect the whole DJing scene for you?
Finito.
Done.
Nadas.
Damn.
Early retirement.
So are you planning afterwards, if things kind of settle, would you know, go back? Or are you trying to, like, venture off into something else?
So you hear it here first. My game plan was always to DJ till I was 35, and I was going to just hang it up.
Really?
That was just my magic number. I've never wanted to be, like, the old guy in the club.
Yeah.
You know, when I came to, like, 21, 22, we would see some of the older guys in the bars, and we're like, yo, this is shit.
Yeah.
And I told myself, I never want to be that guy.
Yeah.
With this all happening, and I've always been into, like, photography, and the marketing I got into because of DJing. I had to get into my own marketing. So that's been really interesting for me. But that being said, because of this COVID, man, I've played a few little things, and I'm like, fuck that 35 rule. I'm going until I'm 45, baby.
Yeah.
I'm refreshed and renewed.
Yeah.
And, like, rededicated. Like, I want to be playing, having fun, making other people have fun. That's right. The main reason why I DJ is other people to have fun for a night.
Right.
Get a night out. Have a good time. Enjoy music. Dance. You know, socialize with your friends.
Not bad.
That's what we love.
No, yeah, yeah, man.
You know, I might not be able to DJ again for 2 years.
Right.
Who knows? But whenever it is, your boy will be ready.
And how much time and how many people, like, of a team does it take to build something like that? Because that was a big event.
Yeah, so specifically, you know? I can talk about the boat race bash. First, it was primarily me and my buddy Marcus, a.k.a. Yeah. Dick Danger. Shout out to my boy,
yeah.
Dick Danger.
Oh, yeah, I remember on the flyers all the time.
So, yeah, and then JJ also DJing, you know, and that those are the three main components of it. And then from there, we started filling in all the pieces.
Yeah.
Hey, you know, we had, we needed sound. I don't have big enough sound to put out that kind of a show.
Yeah.
So we went and got a sound guy. We wanted it to be over the top lights, so we went and got a lighting guy. Mm. We were like, yo, we saw lasers on this show. We went and found a laser guy, you know. So we just started filling in all these spots. And, you know, we got to the point where I was actually at that party the last year before we took it over. And they had a live band, and they had this, and they had that, and it just, it wasn't really put together that well.
Yeah, yeah.
Not to shit on anybody, just the overall party, just, it kind of felt like they knew that this was the show, and they got lackadaisical, the money, you know what I mean? And I came in and was like, yo, Marcus, we gotta, this is it, dude. And he was like, yeah, absolutely. So after that, we started pitching it, and then when we finally got the okay to do it, I mean, we went all in on it. And it, I mean, it's probably realistically 6 months out, you're starting to get some stuff done, and then 3 months out, you're really starting to get all your marketing done, and then a month out, it's gung-ho everything.
Yeah.
You know, so, and it does. It takes a lot of people doing a lot of stuff. You got to have someone taking tickets. You got to have someone, you know, some, me and Marcus would spend days going out and pounding in signs to put the, you know,
shit,
and so. It's a lot of work, man, but in the end, it's like worth it 1,000 times over. Explosive. West Coast shit, my nigga, where she turns the track. Girls that used to turn their back, causing me to yank they arm and pose like I would do them all. Now I'm saying thank you, cause they tell me my shit's the bomb, explosive. But my niggas drinking cognac, smoking weed, all is bad. More than one fire on, chrome rims, flying on. Chronic in your system, let me know. My shit's the bomb.
How'd you get into the collection? What was your first one and what happened? How'd you get there?
Ooh, first one. So I actually don't know which one was my first one. A friend, a coworker of mine, her husband worked for Funko.
Oh, okay. Oh, shit, that's crazy.
So I went to her desk. You know, we have cubicles. We're all in little beehive rows.
Yeah, yeah.
I go to her cubicle and I'm like, what are all these little things?
Yeah.
You know, what are these little guys? And I looked at one. Actually, I can remember the first one I saw, though. I do know that.
Oh, that's dope.
So I hadn't seen any of them that I knew, because she had like some anime ones, and I'm not like super big on anime. So I was like, what are these little toys? And I seen this, and I'm like, oh, snap, Hannibal Lecter.
Yeah.
And she was like, yeah, dude, they're all pop culture things.
Yeah.
But me being a previous collector of toys, I was like, oh, I'm going to start finding the ones that I really like. And then, like, I would buy them as gifts for people.
Oh, okay.
So that's like a big thing, like just for me, because like I enjoy them, and then like I bought them for other people, and then they have like small collections now.
Yeah, because the one you got me now, I'm like, oh, this is dope. So
there you
I
go.
Like, place that in a spot.
Yeah, know? And then next thing you know, you're gonna be like, oh, well,
yeah, they look awesome.
Yeah, and it's just something, and then obviously it's blown out of control.
I remember one time actually being there, I had, and this was at a sports page.
Okay.
Right? And this is probably like my fourth time there. Like, I had been there before, but this is when you were DJing. And you were like, all right, everybody, it's the last call. Bro, everybody started fighting. Like, as soon as you said those words, I just saw chairs. Like, all right, guys.
Oh, you were there.
This is last call. And then I just saw chairs flying. I was like, yo, like, what?
Yeah.
That was wild, bro. Did you have a lot of those, or was that just, you know, one of those nights?
One of the worst nights as far as, like, how to end the night, fighting-wise. Okay. You know, I've been at part of spots where there's been fights and stuff, and usually it's over. And that night, it was just other people started joining in, and chairs got thrown, and bottles got thrown, and da-da-da-da-da. And, you know, for Sports Page, we actually had a little rough streak of fights happening. And I was just like, yo, that's not what I want. That's not what you want. You don't want to go out to the bar and you're worried about, oh, if there's going to be a fight or, you know, whatever else. So we just started 86ing people.
Oh, shit, really?
Hey, you know what? If you're the one that starts fighting.
Out of here.
Yeah, and there's no questions asked.
Yeah.
I'm not going to do the, oh, okay, I'm going to give you another chance. Well, for what?
Yeah.
You already proved to me you can't act like an adult when there's liquor in your system.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not saying there's not situations where things pop off, whatever, but in general, we just started cleaning house and... Mm-hmm. It is what it is, but since then, it's like, man, the amount of problems we had went.
Wait, that was a down. Wild ass night.
It was.
Like, you're editing for, like, or your photography more so,
mm-hmm.
for, like, going on hikes and stuff. You know, how did that happen? Did you just get inspired while you were out there? Like, I got to capture this moment?
Specifically hiking, I've always just, you know, I go hiking to see what's out there. So, to be able to have a camera... You get to capture that moment. And I always just thought it was cool, and I never did anything with them.
Yeah.
And then, you know, Instagram and Facebook came along, and I'd post some stuff up. Because I was doing it in 2005.
Oh, shit.
You know, yeah. I've been hiking basically since then, or backpacking even. And I started getting into Photoshop when I needed to start making my flyers for DJ stuff.
Yeah.
Well, then from there, and I literally didn't edit photos with Photoshop. I made flyers, which is like, now if you look at it, you should be making using them with Illustrator and da-da-da-da-da. But it is what it is. You know, that's all I learned.
You learn.
So then just within the last couple of years, I started getting a little bit more serious with, you know, editing photos to make them look better. Like, if I want to get them printed on my wall and make it look right, how can I make the colors look better? How can I edit this to make this? Oh, there's a stupid sign that... Was it there? Yeah, it was there. But, like, it looks so much better if I just take that out and make it look clean.
Right, yeah. So if you had to choose between DJing and editing.
Ooh. Ooh. Man, you put, like, my two gloves against each other.
Yeah. If you had to, I mean, obviously.
Yeah, I mean, obviously right now, in the world that we're in right now, I'm picking editing.
Right.
Because DJing in your bedroom is like, it's only fun for so long. Eventually, you want to hear the reaction of someone going, oh, you know, but I love, like, exploring Photoshop. I love exploring photography and learning new things about photography. And, man, I've been playing with Photoshop for 10 years now.
Oh, shit.
And I'm telling you, like, if there's a 1 to 100 scale, like, I'm at, like, a 15.
Oh, shoot.
Like, there's people that are...
Deep.
Oh, I mean, I'm not even touching them.
Yeah.
And I'm 10 years in.
That's crazy, man.
Granted, like, I didn't go to school or anything for it, but, you know, just being self-taught and learning and playing with new stuff, and I see some people's stuff, and I'm like,
oh. That's nuts.
Holy cow.
So that makes it more exciting.
For sure, because it's, like,
so much more.
And they're always updating it, so it's always ever expanding. There's always new tools. I'll never be able to catch it.
Yeah,
I'll never be able to say I have 100% mastered it.
Right.
And that, to me, is part of the fun.
What's your favorite Funko? You had to pick one or two. I'll give you two.
Man. See, man, you put pressure on me now. I got so many.
That's why I'm asking. There's a lot. You got Marvel, artists, you got sports.
Okay, I got one for sure. I'll go with just one.
All right.
Number one. Uma Thurman, Pulp Fiction.
Oh,
that's my girl.
Damn, that's dope.
So, Pulp Fiction, all-time favorite movie.
Hard movie.
And at the time, I had, like, started getting into Funkos, like, to the point where I was actually collecting them. I knew that there was Pulp Fiction ones out. Mm. And you could get John Travolta and Samuel Jackson's.
Oh, okay.
They were kind of, you know...
Like the main...
Yeah, they were the main ones. But she, I was like, man, I gotta find Mia Wallace. Like, I gotta find Mia Wallace. I was looking for her. Nowhere to be found, dude. And RIP to Hastings. Hey, I miss you so much.
Same.
But I walked in one day and she was there sitting on the shelf. And I remember being like,
no.
And I'm like kind of looking around like, nah, man. And like, you know, I kind of get that Indiana Jones feeling I was talking about. Like, you're looking for the Holy Grail.
Yeah.
And I see it and I'm just like, and I reach out and I, no joke, I was like, it's got to be the box to the other one or something or something that looks like it. I flipped it around in the middle of Hastings. I was like, let's fucking go! Dude, no shame. And like, my dad was with me and he was like, what? And I was like, Dad, I found Mia Wallace. He's like, get out of here. And I'm like, nope, found her. Let's go. Check it out right now.
It's a wrap.
We're out. Oh, yeah, man. So this was like probably the one that, like, he was a hunt for a while, but he was really nothing compared to her because I've been looking for her for a year. And Funko does it where they actually retire him.
Oh, okay.
So once they've made a certain amount, blah, 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 they go into the vault, they don't make them no more. Oh, that's shit. It. Whatever was out there, you gotta get it on secondhand. So, yeah, if I had to pick one of these, this is Mia Wallace.
That's the way.